Sotheby's and Christie's are selling million-dollar items on Instagram by targeting people who live in Malibu as we speak. Selling art online is happening whether you are in it or not. And the idea that you cannot sell art online because there's nothing that beats the experience of seeing an artwork in real life is laughable. It's laughable. At this moment, I have over 30,000 followers, reaching millions of views and thousands of comments on one single post, as you can see in the screenshots. And I can tell you that with what I know now, I will be able to sell as much with 100 followers as with 30,000 followers. In this video, we will be talking about the number one decision that you will make when it comes to selling art online. A decision that will have an impact on everything else you will do in your art career. A decision that for most artists will be the difference between winning and losing, really. Now, I know what you're thinking.
It's been 1 minute already, and this video is still sponsorship-free. Thank you, Dries. Thank you so much for respecting my time. Is there anything at all that I can do for you?
Well, I'm glad you asked, because there's one thing that you can do, and that is to like this video, which also helps with the algorithm. And on top of that, it's because of your likes that this video is sponsorship free, really. And so thanks a lot. Now, before we go on and explain you the best way to sell your art online, we have to talk about documenting your art, taking pictures or videos. Now, if you followed me for a while, you probably heard some of this already, but keep on listening, because it cannot possibly hurt you to review this very, very quickly. When it comes to taking pictures of your art, the thing that most artists, or businesses for that matter, really constantly underestimate is the cost of complexity. The cost of complexity. When you add more complexity to your workflow, stuff becomes very, very expensive. Let me explain what I mean with that. Now, when you take, for example, pictures with this device, you can take a picture and edit the picture and post the picture online in literally a couple of minutes. But what most of the times happens is that artists have a fancy camera because they're artists, and then they tell themselves, well, I should probably take pictures with this fancy camera because I have this camera anyway. And I'm an artist after all. And they justify it in their own head by saying that it will take them a couple of minutes more, perhaps even an hour. But what happens instead is that because they're taking pictures now with fancy cameras, they have to buy a bigger SD card, which will cost them $70. And also bigger hard drives. And over time, that can easily cost you up to $500 or more, depending on what you take. And because they're taking pictures with their bigger fancy cameras, they of course also need to edit those pictures probably, you know? Because otherwise it's like buying a salmon, an expensive, delicious salmon to put in a burrito where you don't even taste the salmon. And so they decide to buy expensive editing software. And because they're now putting so much time in editing their pictures with their fancy editing software, they also think by themselves, yeah, perhaps I need a course to learn how to edit better. And now they're paying $495 for a course. And because they use their camera gear, expensive camera gear, now so much more, they also increase the chances of letting it fall on the ground and breaking it. And so now they pay an extra $1,000 for a lens to replace the broken lens. And on and on and on. You get the picture. You said to yourself that you should use your fancy camera because you have it and might as well use it, and thought that it would take you another couple of minutes, perhaps an hour. But over the years, it ends up costing you weeks extra and thousands of dollars extra. This is the cost of complexity. If you increase complexity just a little bit, the cost grows exponentially. And so the message here is simple. Keep it as simple as possible. One more thing that we have to mention, besides the financial cost of complexity, there's also an emotional cost of complexity. What I would do, as stated in the beginning, because I was a perfectionist and all of that stuff, I would take pictures with my Sony Alpha 7, Zeiss lens, fancy stuff. And as a result of that, I would start becoming afraid of taking pictures and posting it on social media. because it would take me so much work. I would need to take raw images, then drag it to Lightroom, edit it, then post it on social media to get, what, like 40 likes? I would get 40 likes or 30 likes. That's not worth it, you know? Like you're working an hour for one post that would get 30 likes or two. Like, that's just not going to work. And so, you guessed it. After a while, I just quit doing that. Now, as a result of that, I started to create a lot of regret and doubts about whether or not I was good enough as an artist, because serious artists, they should post, they should harvest the opportunities of the now and post on social media. And so because I was not doing that anymore, I started to become mad at myself for being lazy and unprofessional, and all of that was a very negative experience, when in reality it had nothing to do with me. The process that I was using, namely using a fancy camera, was just not the right process for that desired outcome. And so it boils down to this. The only time that I would take high quality images is if I would sell those images through prints, for example. Every time that people don't pay, I would just use the simplest methods available. So let's go to the important part of this video, selling art online. When it comes to selling art online, you will need a place to sell your art online. Now, I will not go into that very deep. You can choose a website, an online gallery, whatever. I have several videos about that, so I'm not going to dive in that right now. More important than the place you sell your art on will be the ability to drive traffic to that place so that you can actually sell to those people. Now, when it comes to driving traffic, you basically have two options. You can drive traffic through paid advertisement, or you can drive traffic organically. Now, because most artists don't really have a huge advertisement budget, I will talk about the organic methods. When it comes to driving organic traffic, the most important decision that you will make is not what to post, what time to post, or any of those things, but which platforms you choose to post on. If you, for example, post on Facebook and hope that people will see it and then magically buy your art, I can guarantee you that you will lose and that you will not make any sales anytime soon. If you go on Instagram and you post regularly, let's say once a day or a couple of times a week, and you want to grow your audience like that, then you will lose. And so no matter how good your art is, if you make the wrong choice of platform and the wrong tactic on that platform, then you will lose. Now, I know that there are some people out there that tell you that you have to basically pick all platforms and share 50 pieces of content a day. And if you're a business with a lot of employees, you might be able to do that. But if you're a one-man show, an artist, then you cannot do that. Okay, that's impossible. And so you will have to pick one. And don't be mistaken, this is probably the most important decision that you can make when it comes to selling art online, because it will have an impact on every aspect of your art career that follows. An impact on the effectiveness of your copy, of your pictures, of your artworks, of your soft skills, of your landing pages, of everything really. And so it seems like a decision that is easy, that is definitely not a complex decision, like which platform, but there are not going to be a lot of decisions in your art career that are going to have a bigger impact. The only decision that I can think of really is whether or not you should like this video, which would also turn into some good karma for you, by the way. Anyway, let's start off with examining Facebook. First of all, posting on Facebook. Should you do that? In my opinion, that is the biggest waste of time of them all. I mean, that you might as well go on the streets and hand out flyers of your art. It's probably going to work better. And so I would not do that. Should you create a Facebook group, a community where people can find one another with a lot of value, etc., etc., and then drive traffic with that group to things that you want? Perhaps that's possible, but you will need an existing audience for that. And so that is not in line with the title of this book. And on top of that, it's also something that you generally just outsource. This is not a tactic for an artist, a one-man show artist. It's just not the right strategy. And so I would not do that. Going into Facebook groups yourself and then becoming a valuable member, providing value to people. And because you're a valuable member, you create relationships and then you go into cold outreach mode, etc., etc. Like, is that something that you should do? Like, you could do that, but it's very hard. You will need to be an insanely powerful salesperson. I mean, 99% of artists cannot succeed with this strategy. And the quality of your art will not really matter. It's really just sales in this strategy. And so would I recommend this? No, because there are a lot of other strategies, alternatives that are simply way better. And so the only thing that I would do on Facebook is Facebook advertisements. And then you need quite a lot of advertisement skill. And so this is something that you could potentially do, but you need a budget and advertisement skill, which is not the organic method that we would be talking about. And so, no, I would not go on Facebook. It's as simple as that. And I'm not saying this because I have a bad relationship with Facebook. I have 4,000 followers on Facebook. So for me, it would be cool to be on Facebook, but it just simply doesn't work anymore. Let's talk about Twitter next. Now, Twitter is celebrating the written word. It's not a personal platform. It's not visual, so it's very hard to sell art on that platform. And the organic reach on Twitter is nearly zero. So building an audience, building a personal brand on that platform at this moment will be a complete waste of your time. Does this mean that Twitter is not a valuable platform? No. There's one thing that you can do. Because it's a platform that celebrates the written word, there's a lot of academic stuff going on. A lot of academic people, journalists, curators, art historians, etc., etc. And so what you should be doing, if you want to go that route, is to make a list of 500 people, academic people that are on Twitter with art profiles, and then you get their posts in your Twitter newsfeed, and then you reply to their stuff. And a lot of those people actually not have a lot of followers, because that's just the type of platform that it is, and those people are not necessarily famous. We're talking about journalists, unknown journalists, and so, but they're very active on that platform. And so what you're going to do is then reply to their stuff, and as a result of that, they will become familiar with you. You will create a relationship, which will mean that they will open your messages and receive your pitch. And so that is a good way to reach those types of people if you want to be featured in magazines or in academic publications or anything like that. Now, this is a powerful tactic. I've used this myself years and years and years ago. And I know something about PR. I have been featured in some famous magazines like Vice, Fubis, stuff like that. But here's the thing. This is a very time-consuming type of strategy. And so you will not be able to, as a one-man show, to combine it with other audience-building type of strategies or anything like that. And so you will not build an audience. You will not sell art through this method. It's not because you're featured in famous magazines that people will come and then find your work and then suddenly buy art from you. That's not how it goes. And so this is a cool strategy, but not a sales strategy. And so in short, can you sell art on Twitter? Can you drive a lot of traffic through Twitter to your website or your online sales page or whatever, and then sell art? The answer is no, you cannot. And so if that's what you're doing on Twitter, then you're really completely wasting your time. I saved the best for last, Instagram and YouTube. But before we go on, I have to point out that I'm here to help artists out, to help you sell art online or offline or whatever. And so at this moment, I'm building a membership site, very similar to Patreon, where artists will learn how to sell art, learn from one another, learn from me, and make money. If you're interested in that, or if you just want to see how a fellow artist, me, writes a sales email, you can put yourself on the waiting list, link in the description. Let's go further and talk about Instagram. Now, first of all, a lot of people think that you can grow organically on Instagram at this moment, but I can tell you that it's going to be extremely hard doing so by posting pictures of your art or whatever, anything like that, on a daily basis, for example. It's going to be extremely hard, and I would not recommend that, because there are just simply other methods available at this moment, other alternatives that are going to be way better for you at this moment. If you want to grow organically, for example, then posting on TikTok regularly would have been way better in the last year than posting on Instagram, for example. And TikTok is not the only platform like that. And on top of that, we also have to take in mind that Instagram is owned by Facebook. And if we look at the history of Facebook, the way they took organic reach down and down and down and down, that is probably going to happen with Instagram as well, even more than it already did. And so growing organically on Instagram, I wouldn't recommend it. Now, does this mean that Instagram is a bad choice? No. Virtually the entire art world is on Instagram at this moment. And the platform, therefore, is at this moment a very powerful place to do some advertisement. On top of that, I know a lot of people, a lot of artists who had a medium following. We are talking 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 followers, 10,000 followers, who then got approached by galleries on Instagram. And Instagram basically made their art career possible in that beginning sessions. And so that Instagram is very powerful. On top of that, there's a lot of sales possible in the DM section as well. And it is probably the most, if not one of the most important research tools for artists and art professionals alike. You can basically find all the secrets of the art world in the Instagram hashtags. You can literally see who the next big art stars will be by looking at those hashtags. And so you can connect with them right before they boom. I think Instagram is probably one of the most important sales tools out there. And you can also just build relationship with your audience way better on Instagram than, for example, on YouTube. Replying to a YouTube comment is less personal than talking in the DMs of Instagram. The last platform that I'm going to talk about is YouTube. Now, YouTube is the second biggest search engine in the world. And so this results in a very steady flow of constant organic reach, which means that you, if you are able to rank, can guarantee organic reach for as long as YouTube will exist. And so this is something that no other social media platform at this moment is able to offer. On top of that, through the whole AdSense system of YouTube, you will be able to make money very quickly, very early on in your social media trajectory. I at this moment have 2,500 followers, which is nothing. And I'm making, in AdSense alone, in between 300 and 400 euro a month on YouTube. And so that's a lot, considering, I mean, 2,500 subscribers is nothing, you know? And many artists, many people actually don't know that YouTube is way more lucrative than any of the other social media platforms out there. 100,000 subscribers on YouTube is going to be way more valuable than 1 million subscribers on Instagram, even though 1 million is 10 times bigger than 100,000. And so this is something to consider. On top of all of this, YouTube is also the perfect platform to expand from. You can easily turn a YouTube video into other pieces of content. For example, you take the YouTube script and turn it into a blog post. You cut the YouTube video into several small pieces and post it on Instagram. Or turn it into some Pinterest, whatever shizzles. You know, you can strip the audio from your YouTube video and turn it into a podcast, etc., etc., etc. So you can easily, out of one YouTube video, a 20-minute YouTube video, you can easily turn it into 40 pieces of different content for different social media platforms. You cannot do that with an Instagram post. Once you understand the things that I just mentioned about YouTube, about all these platforms, you start to understand that you have to bring your goals in line with the platform. And that is truly the only way to succeed online. If you want to grow organically and you're posting on Instagram, for example, you know that you will lose. Because what you should be doing is posting on TikTok. If you want to create real relationships with your audience, you should be using the Instagram DMs. If you want to do PR stuff, you should go on Twitter and do those types of things. If you want to drive a lot of traffic, you can use YouTube or blogs and boom, drive traffic like that. If you want to sell directly, there's a lot of possibility going on in the Instagram DM sections. If you want to do research within the art world, then Instagram again is your platform, etc., etc., etc. After you made a choice on which platform you are going to use to drive a lot of traffic, it's time to learn how to sell art, how to find collects online and bring them to those places as well. And so, and you're not going to do that by talking about your art. People resist what they are being told and never doubt the things that they conclude. And so if you are interested, if you want to learn how to sell art on Instagram, I would recommend to watch my video, How to Sell Art on Instagram Without Having a Lot of Followers. My name is Dries Ketels, and I hope to see you around. Ciao, ciao.